this list in our number 10 spot, we have cows. Cows are one of the sweetest and cutest animals out there, and it totally makes sense why people call them grass puppies. The area around Chernobyl was known for its agriculture before the disaster, so of course that means there were definitely a lot of cows that could be found. Since farm animals are not only expensive, but can also be used as a source of income, many people took their farm animals with them, but many of these animals had already been exposed to the radiation in some capacity, and while it didn't affect them right away, the newer generations saw much more of the effects. In 1989, many farmers began reporting birth defects in their animals, some being much more severe than others. As time went on, the cows became less mutated, but that doesn't mean the effects went away. As the cows continued to graze on feed that was contaminated, the effects became more internal. This has led completely normal-looking cows near the exclusion zone to begin producing milk that is toxic and not fit for consumption. This is just one of the clear examples of how, even though the visible effects may have worn off, there are still lasting effects that we probably hadn't previously considered. In our number 9 spot today, we have barn swallows. Any animal who lives in the exclusion zone have been affected by the disaster, and that includes those who spend most of their time in the sky. I'm obviously talking about birds. The barn swallows in Chernobyl are one animal who have seen a change in their physical appearance that has lasted all of the years since the nuclear meltdown. It is unclear why these birds have been affected greater than their land animal counterparts, or if these changes will ever reverse to their previous state, but here's what they are currently dealing with. The swallows appear to have severely deformed beaks, disproportionate feathers, some had partial albinism, and they were seen to have much smaller brains. Of course, some of these issues are much worse than others, and I'm sure these changes have significantly affected their ways of life, but of course they continue to adapt as time goes on. It is sad that this human-made disaster has affected them in such a negative way, but the fact that they are still around really shows their adaptability and resilience. In our number 8 spot today, we have boars. Boars are often seen wandering around the exclusion zone, but they also make their way into the surrounding towns as well, which is creating quite a problem. Boars are a fairly common food source, and it's not unusual to come across one, but here's the problem if you live in the area. How are you supposed to tell which boars are radioactive and which aren't? Basically, you can't until it's too late. The boars who aren't radioactive might come across and intermingle with one who is, but they also like to eat mushrooms, and if they're searching for their food within the exclusion zone, it's a highly likely possibility that they'll find themselves eating a radioactive mushroom. This is posing quite a problem. In 2017, there was a study that found that approximately 1 out of every 3 boars that were killed in the nearby areas of Germany, which for the record isn't even that close to Chernobyl, have been found to be radioactive and super unsafe for human consumption. You'd think that being that far away would make you safe, but as we clearly now know, the effects of the disaster stretched far and wide. In our number 7 spot today, we have Przewalski's horse. These horses first originated in Mongolia and were wild horses that became endangered. They first became endangered due to hunters who would often kill the stallion, which of course would provide many difficulties in terms of reproduction. These horses weren't doing well in captivity, which made things even more difficult. This, combined with the harsh winters, which would often claim their lives, left things looking quite grim for the species. In the late 1990s, however, in an effort to help repopulate these animals, 30 of them were released into the Ukrainian side of the exclusion zone, and it is believed that some of these original horses are actually still alive today, which is amazing, but camera trap images have also shown young horses, which means that they are repopulating, which is a huge win. Their expanding population in such a harsh environment could mean that they might potentially be able to return from the brink and go on to continue as a species, which is something we always want to see. In our number 6 spot today, we have cats. In the rush of the evacuation, many pets were left behind in Chernobyl, and that of course includes cats. With little to do, and of course more kittens being born, this paved the way for a group of feral cats to take over the exclusion zone. These cats wander in and out of the zone and find all of their favorite snacks, such as radioactive rodents or the less common radioactive insects. These cats certainly have had quite a difficult time surviving, as they are a perfect tasty snack for much larger predators and are certainly not equipped to deal with the harsh winters, but even still, there is said to be at least 100 stray cats living in the exclusion zone. There are efforts underway to have the uncontaminated ones put up for adoption, but the difficulty is in testing them and also re-domesticating these animals who have had to fend for themselves for so long. In our number 5 spot today, we have dogs. Since we just talked about the cats who were sadly left behind, it's only fair we talk about the dogs too. It's strange that these two domesticated animals would have such different experiences after the disaster, but they absolutely have. There are far more dogs who have managed to survive throughout the years than cats, but that is most likely due to the fact that they aren't as easy to catch and eat as prey as cats are. But dogs have a whole other challenge, and that is they have a hard time hunting and feeding themselves. There are workers who continue to work the dangerous job at the plant, and they continually feed the dogs living in the zone, which is something that truthfully is so nice to hear. It is also said that there are dogs living in this area that have begun mating with wolves, which is only going to breed dogs that will be more likely to be able to survive on their own, which I suppose is a good thing. Similar to the cats, many of the stray dogs are being studied to see if they can be adopted into homes outside of the zone so that they don't have to continue living in these harsh environments that they really were not bred for. In our number 4 spot today, we have European gray wolves. One of the species of animals that has been thriving ever since the disastrous nuclear meltdown has been the European gray wolf. Due to the lack of humans in the Chernobyl Exclusion Zone, they have been able to thrive, and it has been said that the wolves in this area actually have a population that is 7 times higher than that of comparable sites. Researchers are still trying to figure out exactly why this is happening, but it has obviously shown them that despite the effects of radiation in humans, the radiation clearly isn't affecting the wildlife's ability to reproduce. So, this seems like just a regular gray wolf, but here's where things get a little different. Just because the wolves seem to be doing fine doesn't mean they aren't radioactive. These wolves, since they're such a high population, are beginning to travel farther and spread out more, which creates quite a problem. Not that we're just going up and petting wolves, but if you did come in contact with one of these wolves, you'd be getting a high dose of radiation just by touching them. Touching a carcass of these wolves with bare hands is absolutely not recommended. So while it is absolutely incredible to see the wildlife doing so well in this zone, we are now faced with an entirely different issue that we haven't really ever had before. In our number 3 spot today, we have the Eurasian lynx. This one is on this list for a different reason than most. It isn't because of anything this animal is or isn't doing, but instead is due to the fact that this animal was once believed to have entirely disappeared from Europe. It was fairly recently in 2014 that researchers realized they had made a comeback in a big way. Similar to most of the animals we've talked about today, the Eurasian lynx has been able to thrive due to the lack of human population and interference. Their downfall was attributed to urbanization as well as hunters, and they were mostly wiped out in the early 20th century, although they remained in certain parts of Siberia. There is still a lot more research that needs to be done about these creatures to determine exactly how radioactive they are, and this will take time due to the dangers of the zone they reside in, as well as the nature of these creatures in general. But just being able to see that an animal that was struggling has been able to make such a comeback is probably one of the best things to come out of such a horrible disaster. In our number 2 spot today, we have bison. Bison are right up there with wolves for most dangerous radioactive animal, and that is due to their size, as well as the fact that they are a source of food for some. These huge animals can weigh up to 2,200 pounds and are certainly not an animal that is easily messed with. Many bison weren't affected by the radiation immediately, and instead it became much more of an issue once they started eating food that had been contaminated. They like to feed on grass, and a lot of it, and the radiation didn't only affect animal life, but plant life as well, making their food source a literal feeding ground for radioactive material. Similar to the wolves we talked about before, running into these guys isn't only a threat now because of their size, but now because if you get too close, you could be facing some unsafe levels of radiation. In our number 1 spot today, we have spiders. I've talked about my hatred for spiders a lot on this channel, but to be honest, they keep doing cool things, so I have to keep talking about them. Okay, well maybe this one is less cool and more scary, but still, they deserved a spot. Spiders that are residing within the exclusion zone are of course radioactive, but it's not only the spiders that are now dangerous to touch, but it is also their webs. Spiders in Chernobyl are literally making radioactive webs, which is the stuff straight out of a comic book. These radioactive webs are also being woven in much different ways than they were before, which would suggest some sort of genetic mutation at play. Spiders were already a creature I'd like to stay far, far away from, but radioactive spiders really adds a whole other level. Not only are the spiders now dangerous for non-radioactive animals to touch, but walking through their web is equally as dangerous to those who aren't thriving in the radiation. So not only do you have to watch out for the regular old radioactive material, but now also the never-ending construction of radioactive webs. Great.
Starting us off at number 10, we have the beautiful red fox. Since the devastating events of the Chernobyl explosion back in 1986, the exclusion zone has pretty much become a ghost town. But only for humans. As far as wildlife is concerned, this place is booming like Vegas on a Friday night. One of the most often seen animals there is the highly adaptable red fox. Red foxes are known to thrive in many different kinds of environments, from urban and rural areas, from Canada all the way to Australia, and Chernobyl is no exception. The red fox is not exactly accustomed to humans, especially near Chernobyl, so most of these foxes are not actually scared of the tourists that do explore the exclusion zone every year. Many visitors report that these foxes actually approach them hoping for a little treat. Now, how sweet is that? In a previous video, I don't hold back my fear of the piles of old dolls that also inhabit Chernobyl, but if I have the chance to get close to a red fox and maybe become best friends with it, I might just have to go. But what's actually weird about it? Well, there's nothing that will stick out more in a 35-year-old ghost town of one of the biggest radiation blasts ever than a beautiful red fox. The dolls make sense to me. The foxes, they need to relocate to like my backyard where I can feed them and love them forever because, crikey, I love wildlife. At number 9, we have elk. Back in 2018, tourists spotted this large creature in a water tank at Chernobyl. And no, it wasn't a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle. It was a poor, stranded, full-size elk. As far as its age and its ninja skills, that is unknown. This large and beautiful creature somehow fell into the water tanks between the 5th and the 6th reactors and was reportedly stuck in the radioactive water for 3 days. Tourists called the local fire department to come and help save the poor animal. One firefighter tethered a rope to its antlers so that while being towed by the boat back to safety, the animal could keep its head above water. The entire rescue took about an hour before the elk was brought up onto the bank, where it then rested for about 4 hours before finally making its way back to the forest for some much needed R&R. No one quite knows how it got in the tank, but many believe it was running away from wolves or some other type of predator and accidentally fell into the tank after. A local radiation expert, Dennis Vizhnevitsky, said the radiation dose it had would not be fatal. The elk will survive in spite of taking a big radiation dose. If you ask me, this sounds like the birth of a superhero, you know? Like the wolves chase the elk, the elk falls into a radioactive river, it resubmerges with radioactive superpowers, and then it seeks out its revenge on the wolves? Come on, it writes itself. Joking aside, bless the hearts of everyone involved saving that poor animal. But I would be on the lookout for a mutated elk out there, because after swimming in radioactive water for 3 days, dang, that's gotta do something. At number 8, we have the cousin of the radioactive elk, the radioactive deer. Back in 1986, during the Chernobyl blast, most of Western Russia and Europe was blanketed by a toxic cloud. That toxic cloud reached all the way out to Norway and impacted the wildlife there almost as much as it did in the Ukraine. In central and southern Norway, the migratory reindeer often feed on lichen and fungus, two foods of the reindeer that were exposed to large amounts of radiation from that toxic cloud. These reindeer now contain higher levels of radioactivity that are beyond the European Union limit for consumption, which is a huge problem for the indigenous people of the area, known as the Sami. The Sami heavily rely on the reindeer for being one of their best sources of food, and yet for the first time ever, they're being told it is not safe to eat some of these animals. Just days after the blast in 1986, the government tested the radiation in the reindeer and measured anywhere between 30,000 to 60,000 becquerel per kilogram. This forced authorities to raise the limit of acceptable radiation found in animals from 600 becquerel per kilogram to 3,000, so the Sami still had enough food sources to sustain them. Lavrent Skutrud, an environmental radiation expert of the Norway Radiation Protection Authority, says it is important to remember that the permissible levels are not toxic limits. The limits are instead intended to minimize the amount of radiated food people consume every year, generally trying to keep it below 80,000 a year. The levels of radiation have fallen over the years, and there are still spikes from time to time. While these reindeer were studied in Norway and not exactly Chernobyl, deer are abundant in the exclusion zone and are known to migrate far distances. So, from Chernobyl all the way to Norway, you can find large numbers of radioactive deer. That sounds weird. Coming in at number 7, we have brightly colored birds. That's right, bright colored little birds. Creepy, am I right? Now, okay, I know this one is a little vague, but let me tell you why it's specifically these birds. Professor Timothy Mousseau and Dr. Anders Moeller studied 1,570 birds in the forests and surrounding areas of Chernobyl. They found that the populations of birds that were colored red, orange, and yellow, such as the yellowhammer, have decreased more than those of larger and less vibrant colors. The reason being? Antioxidants and carotenoids. Birds that produce carotenoids have brighter colors. Producing those bright colors, laying large eggs, and migrating large distances uses up a large amount of antioxidants in the bird's body, making them more susceptible to higher levels of radiation and decreasing their populations. Among the species that were most impacted are orioles, blackbirds, blue-tailed quails, hoopoes, and robins. I was really hoping the radiation was the reason these birds were bright colored, and that maybe there was a tie-dye oriole out there or something, but I'm afraid I'm out of luck. Staying with the bird theme, coming in at number 6 is the white-tailed eagle. Unlike the small, colorful, radioactive birds, the endangered white-tailed eagle is thriving in the Ukraine. University of Georgia researchers completed a month-long camera study laying dead fish carcasses near the riverbeds of the exclusion zone to see what kinds and how many different predator species would come and feed off the dead fish. James Beasley of Savannah River Ecology Laboratory said, "We've seen evidence of a diversity of wildlife in the CEZ through our previous research, but this is the first time that we've seen white-tailed eagles, American mink, and river otter on our cameras." Imagine watching an endangered species come flocking back in large numbers to feed in only one area. Hey, maybe radioactive fish just tastes a bit better. As much as I love seafood though, I think I'm just gonna leave it for the eagles. Coming in at our halfway point, number 5, we have the European brown bear. Reported back in 2014 for the first time in 100 years, a brown bear was seen in the exclusion zone of Chernobyl. A Ukrainian collaborator for the Transfer Exposure Effects Research Program by the name of Sergei Gaschek set up cameras hoping to learn more about the effects of the radioactivity in the area when all of a sudden, one night on camera, a brown bear decided to make its big entrance back into Chernobyl. Brown bears are not the first large mammal to be seen in the exclusion zone, but it is definitely something to celebrate after a brown bear pieces out of there 100 years ago. Project leader Mike Woods from the University of Salford reported that, "We are basically working on the assumption that as you move people out of the equation and human pressure and disturbance is removed, then any animals that have a corridor into the exclusion zone find they are suddenly away from the pressures and dangers presented by people." So basically, this radioactive ghost town is a heaven on earth for all of our large furry friends. But hey, as long as you got the bear necessities, who cares what it looks like? I wonder if our buddy Bigfoot ever vacations there. At number 4, going down in size from the European brown bear, we have firebugs. Little radioactive bugs who spontaneously combust and fly around the Ukraine terrorizing people. It's mayhem! Just kidding. Sadly, it's not as cool as that. Sorry. Back in April of 2011, our good friends Anders Moeller and Timothy Mousseau were collecting flowers in the famous Red Forest to study their pollen when they came across these little firebugs. They collected a few hundred of these little bugs and compared the markings on bugs from places of higher radiation to those of places of lower radiation. The result? Firebugs from higher radiation spots tended to have missing or deformed markings on them, such as missing dots or eyes, as some others call them. There you have it. What happens when a bug becomes radioactive? It loses a spot. Wow. Starting us off in our top 3 is arguably the most intelligent mammal on Earth. Humans. That's right, we are technically animals, and you can find humans in the exclusion zone almost every day of the year. In one of my previous videos, I told you all that there are actual tours to the Chernobyl site, and around 12,000 tourists visit the site every year. That's 32.8767123 people a day, because that makes sense. From 2014 to 2018, Meredith Yeager, the team leader of the US National Cancer Institute, sequenced the genomes of 130 children that were conceived after the 1986 disaster. They looked at children born from 1987 to 2002, as well as the genomes of the children's parents, with at least one of the parents being exposed to and within 45 miles of the 1986 blast. While the tests proved that the children of Chernobyl survivors and witnesses didn't carry more genetic mutations, some of those originally exposed did develop thyroid cancers. Studies found that more radiation exposed and the younger the person was increased the chances of developing the cancer. But of course, nowadays radioactive levels are much lower and measurements are taken with a dosimeter every single day to verify the safety for human exploration. So, if you want to go to Chernobyl or already have been, please let me know what it was like down in the comments. Coming in at number 2 is a real weird one. A giant catfish. Seriously. Over in Chernobyl's cooling pond, giant catfish can be seen swimming and even the odd time caught by adventurous fishermen. Back in 2016, a video surfaced of the massive aquatic animal in Chernobyl's cooling pond, and sure enough, many people thought it to be some kind of mutated monster fish. But whether we wish it was or not, radiation is not the reason for its massive size. The Wells catfish is a species known to reach gargantuan size. Some of these fish can reach up to 800 pounds, but are extremely rare due to the fact that most of the time they are mistaken for beluga sturgeon, or just exaggerated. It is entirely possible for these creatures to reach up to 350 pounds though, and that is still a massive fish to me. Italian fisherman Dino Ferrari caught one back in May of 2016, and this thing looks crazy. In the cooling ponds of Chernobyl, there is no real competition or higher predators of this giant fish, so it has more than enough food available to keep them packing on those gains and stay well fed. I never thought I would say this, but I think I'm scared of a catfish. Finally, coming in at our number one spot is definitely the weirdest animal on there. It's the raccoon dog. These half raccoon, half dog looking animals are a topic of controversy with some authorities, arguing if it is a member of the dog family or a member of the raccoon family, or the much more scientific name for it, part of the procyonid family. Yeah. Raccoon sounds better. These crazy interesting animals are native to Eastern Asia as well as quite common in the exclusion zone of Chernobyl. Once again, this is not a really cool radioactive combination of a raccoon and a dog, but just another animal that isn't exactly sure which family it is a part of. In a study completed by the ecologist James Beasley, it was discovered that raccoon dogs were just one of the many species of mammals that are thriving in the exclusion zone. He even got his picture taken with one, and I gotta say, it's so fluffy! For the longest time, I really wanted to get a dog, and I didn't care what breed it was, but now, I think I want a raccoon dog.